Hey, Bill Nye, the science guy here.
This is Salman Rushdie.
Hi, this is Julia Sweeney.
I'm Neil deGrasse Tyson.
This is Keel Wilson.
Hi, this is Dar Williams.
I'm Mr. Deity, and you're listening to the Humanist Hour. I command you to listen now, or I will smite you.
Yes, I am a sound scientist. Came to evaluate the evidence on a closed case, highly classified, confidential, in a race against the clock.
Hi, this is Todd.
And this is Margaret Downey.
And welcome to the Humanist Hour, the official podcast of the American Humanist Association.
Humanism is about family, compassion, reason, science, human rights, social justice, and civil liberties.
Welcome to the show, Margaret. Margaret Downey here is a guest host this month and has had a prolific career in the free thought movement for, gosh, she's a veteran if there is any in the movement. She's been around as kind of a pioneer, if you will. She's the founder and president of the Free Thought Society, which she founded back in 1993, a former president of the Atheist Alliance International, and also a former board member of right here, the American Humanist Association. Welcome to the show, Margaret.
Thank you. I'm so glad you didn't call me an old sage.
I was thinking about it, but
oh. I'd rather be a pioneer woman.
So tell our listeners a little bit more about you.
Well, I am very happy to be a co-host today, of course, and I'm so involved in the atheist community and the humanist community and the free thought community that sometimes people don't know exactly where my affiliations lie, but I'm very involved with cooperation and making sure that our community, the non-theist community, is represented in the media and in public as a rainbow of thought. And to that end, we try very hard at the Free Thought Society to set up tables, which we call the potpourri of philosophy.
Mm-hmm.
And we have literature, everything from A to Z, with every national group being represented. Because it's our feeling that people are looking for a philosophical home and they just need to know where to look. So that's part of our job function as the Free Thought Society, is to appeal to the non-affiliated people.
You've been a selfless giver of time for many years in this movement. What got you involved originally and when did you get involved?
My passion for fighting discrimination goes back to childhood. When in my childhood, I was reared in the South and saw a lot of violations of civil rights in the 1950s. And as a child, I couldn't fight for any type of justice. But as an adult, it's a passion that I can't control. Principles and doing the right thing just comes out where I've jeopardized my job. I've lost jobs. It's been a real passion that, you know, once you have a passion, you just really have to go with it because that's what's going to make you the most happy. When you find a job you love and you love what you do, you don't even have to get paid. The satisfaction is enough.
Well, I want to thank you because you've kind of been one of the key people who's paved the way for me to be an activist at all and for there even to be a movement for me to be involved in. So thank you for everything you've done. I really appreciate it. And it's awesome to have you here.
Thank you, Todd.
So let's see. Let's start talking about what's new. One new thing is AHA was an ally with Foundation Beyond Belief and many other organizations in the movement on the first annual Foundation Beyond Belief effort to raise money for the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society. And what's pretty cool is we actually, together as a movement, broke LLS's all-time record for most money raised by a non-corporate team in their first year. We raised $430,000 last year.
Oh, congratulations on that.
Yeah, congratulations to all of us. It's pretty sweet. It's amazing. We actually also were their fourth largest overall international team last year, which I'm sure surprised the heck out of them, us coming out of nowhere, and actually had more local teams than any of their partners did. We had 150 teams across the U.S. and Canada, and really showed up to have a presence in our local neighborhoods, getting out there, living our values, supporting scientific research, compassionate support, and really living humanism on a day-to-day basis and a really out there visible basis. So I think it's just, it's really cool. And we're doing it again this year. We just kicked off 2013. So folks, anybody out there wants to take part or form a team in, with your local group, you can go to fbbls.org and learn more.
Well, I think it's changing the face of non-theism. It's really showing that we have a vibrant and volunteer base in our non-theist community that is making a difference. And so we have something to boast about now. You know, we have proof, evidence that we are moral and involved people who are generous beyond belief.
Exactly. It's something we've been doing for years on our own, but often with different organizations or independently. And it's just cool because this is one more piece of a trend of the movement organizing in our own name and doing things we were already doing. But as we do it, doing it in such a way that kind of surprises people, breaks down negative stereotypes and, you know, shows our friends and family and neighbors like, hey, wow, these people have some of the same values I do. They care about some of the things we care about.
And doing so in a secular way.
Exactly. So year one, big success. Year two, kicking off now, starting the ball on tradition. So you know, listeners, please join us on this. It's going to be a lot of fun. Margaret, what's new with you? What's going on in your neck of the woods and your role in the movement?
Well, we talked about all the time that I donate to the non-theist community, but I also make a living by having a business called Secular Celebrations. And I'm very proud to say that I have added a business partner who is a graduate of the Clergy Project. His name is Mike Oss, and he joined me in my business to offer secular celebration types of weddings, baby naming ceremonies, funerals, the same thing he did as a minister, but in a secular way. We're trying to provide our community with options for, you know, celebrating great events in a person's life.
Mike is the leader of Houston Oasis, is that correct?
Yes, and I'm so proud that Secular Celebrations is extending outward in over the United States, in that my dream is to have a secular officiant in every state so that we can service the non-theist community well.
I think that's awesome because, frankly, as our movement grows and as we mature, I think it's super critical to provide some of the same services that religion has provided in the past. And, you know, just a new study came out like this week. It was actually posted on the AHA site, a Facebook page this morning, you know, showing that the number of people in the U.S. that are not affiliated with religion has hit its highest ever, which, you know, is just continuing the trend. This seems to happen every time a new study comes out, just about the number just keeps pushing higher and higher and higher. These religious non-affiliated people, they still get married. They still come of age. And part of being a human and something that's great is having ceremonies, having, you know, celebrations of life at different stages. And more of these services are going to be needed out there. So I think that's just awesome.
Yes, and we really enjoy providing these types of rituals and traditions that really explain who we are and what our principles are. And it's so important for not only young couples to convey this to their family, but to have an alternative. So, you know, a lot of families are pressured into getting their children baptized, and they can come back and say, well, no, you know, instead of a baptism, I want to have a baby naming ceremony where it involves explaining how we came up with the name for our child. We assign guide parents instead of God parents. So that's one of my favorite types of ceremonies to perform. And, you know, Mike Oss is going to be a wonderful business partner. It was very easy for him because what I did was I provided him a website connection, business cards, template for his billing, and it was a very easy process for him. And I want to offer that to other Clergy Project graduates as an easy way to begin their business when they decide to leave the church.
It's funny you talk about. I think you used the phrase "guide parents."
Yes,
I'm kind of surprisingly, maybe to some, a godfather twice over. And so I've tried to convince them now that they should call me the Todd father rather than the godfather, because it's, the godfather just doesn't work for me anymore. But I still take the role seriously. I still try to be a part of their lives and a mentor and somebody who's there for them and kind of goes one step above just another one of their parents, friends, or relatives. So I think that's fantastic. And, you know, speaking of Mike Oss and former clergy, that leads right in rather conveniently to the topic of today's show. We're talking about the Clergy Project and have on some awesome guests today.
Yes, I'm so excited that today we're going to be talking to Teresa MacBain, Jerry Dewitt, and Catherine Dunphy.
Yeah, they are all former clergy members who are part of the Clergy Project now, and they're actually all out as former clergy, which not all the members of the Clergy Project are. And they've been doing some amazing things and actually doing a great job of getting out in the media and talking about who we are and what our movement's doing. Let's kick off with Catherine. Catherine is the acting executive director, I believe is the title, for the Clergy Project. Tell us what the Clergy Project is. Tell our listeners.
Well, thanks, Todd, for the warm welcome. The Clergy Project is an online community for nonbelieving clergy persons and former clergy persons. So ministers, priests, rabbis, nuns, some theologians, chaplains, etc. What we all have in common is that we are all non-believers, and we all have a commitment to being a community and being friends and supporting one another, because it's a struggle when you come up against that wall of doubt and recognize that you have to overcome it and get on the other side.
Teresa and Jerry, can you tell us a little bit about what your role and history is with the Clergy Project?
Okay, this is Teresa. I guess Jerry is being the Southern gentleman and letting the lady go first, which is typical of Jerry. If you don't know him, that's very typical. My journey with the Clergy Project began in 2011, late summer. I'd been struggling with my faith as a Methodist pastor for a period of time, actually for many, many years. I just didn't realize that was what was happening. And about midsummer 2011, I came to the stark realization that I no longer believed, but I didn't know where to go or what to do or who to trust or talk to. And through a Google search, I found Dan Barker's name in his book, Godless. I read it rather quickly, contacted the Freedom from Religion Foundation, and lo and behold, Dan called me. During our phone conversation, he told me about the Clergy Project, which had just started. It wasn't even public yet, and he invited me to be a part of it. Well, needless to say, I felt like, pardon the expression, I'd died and gone to heaven. I found a group, I think there were about 60 folks just like me who were struggling, who were fighting. Catherine was there, Jerry was there, many others. And I mean, honestly, guys, it was an absolute lifesaver for me.
Wow.
And I'm just so grateful that, you know, that it exists and continues. And I think I was actually number 59 or 60 that came in the project. There are way over 400 now. Catherine, you can correct me on the numbers, it's just an amazing group of people. And I wouldn't be here today, I don't think, if it weren't for the Clergy Project.
And the Clergy Project actually started in 2008, or was it 2007?
Can I answer that, Margaret?
Yes, please.
The Clergy Project, there were conversations that happened before the Clergy Project emerged as a private website, between Dan Barker and Richard Dawkins, and also the study that Linda LaScola and Daniel Dennett did on preachers that are not believers, out of Tufts University. So I first became aware that this phenomenon existed after I read the study, the Tufts study, when it was brought to my attention by a local humanist group that I was affiliated with in 2010. So prior to 2011, the Clergy Project was kind of a loose idea. It wasn't yet formulated. It didn't become an actual safe haven / online forum until March 2011. But prior to that, it was just there was a kind of a knowing that this phenomenon was there, that there were non-believing active and formerly active clergy persons.
Great.
Yeah, I recall Richard talking about it back in 2009 as kind of like a big idea that he wanted to make happen sometime in the future. And I guess I want to take this opportunity to give a kudos to Dan and Richard's respective organizations, the Freedom From Religion Foundation and Richard Dawkins Foundation, because I know they've been really key in helping the Clergy Project get ramped up.
And we especially thank Linda LaScola for all of her research and Daniel Dennett for picking up on it. I will never forget that they actually met person face-to-face at the 2007 conference that I hosted at Crystal City. And it was such a great pleasure to see them talking and going over the papers and making plans.
This is Catherine. I have to say that we owe all the members of the Clergy Project owe a real debt to these founders who, you know, knew that we were out there, even though we didn't know we were out there. Like, from my perspective, I thought it was some sort of anomaly. Like, how can you go through studying, you know, theology at the undergrad and graduate level and turn out as an atheist? Like, you know, I thought I was a weirdo, that I was in some sort of individual silo for many, many years. And when I found out about the study, I was over the moon just to know there were other people that were in the same predicament. They have given us a gift, whether they recognize it, you know, or not. They've given us the opportunity to create and foster a community. And I don't think that really there are any words to say how thankful we all are for that.
Jerry, do you want to chime in with your thoughts? As the Southern gentleman, I want to make sure you get a little bit of chance to throw in your history here.
Well, thank you, Todd. My sentiments are very similar to both Catherine's and Teresa's. Like Catherine, I feel like that the Clergy Project is truly a gift. And also like Catherine, I felt like I was completely alone. I had absolutely no clue and truly no reason to believe that I was one of many people all across the country and, as we now know, the world, that were active in the ministry but yet was struggling with doubts or knew that they were now agnostic or atheist. So it came to me, as Teresa was also explaining, as a great relief to find my brothers and sisters, if you will, and to discover that I was not simply engaged in some form of self-destructive process. I stood and looked myself in the mirror and asked, who am I to be questioning this? Am I more sincere than Martin Luther? Am I more theologically in tune than John Calvin? How is it possible that I, this little Southern boy from the backwoods of Louisiana, I figured out the great mystery that all of, you know, my heroes had not? And so it was extremely comforting to suddenly make contact with all of these other beautiful and sincere people that also graduated from their theology.
And congratulations to you, Jerry, for writing Hope After Faith. When does that actually become available?
It's available for pre-order now. You know, that's the fascinating thing about the publishing industry, It was actually already on Amazon and other sites whenever we had less than 10,000 words written for pre-order. Actually, I had a friend, not Catherine, but another Canadian friend I was Skyping with, and he says, yeah, I just ordered your book today. And I said, no, you didn't. We're only 10,000 words in. And he said, yeah, it's on Amazon. I ordered it today.
And you'll get all 10,000 words.
Yeah, that's right. You have all 10,000 words for $25. But the actual book will be published June the 25th.
Well, we look forward to that publication, and we look forward to the movie that will probably be made based on the book and your story. And I'm picturing Ben Affleck as portraying you.
Well, if you've seen Argo, then I've kind of got a Ben Affleck look going myself, just because I'm a lover of the 70s, and I haven't gotten a haircut since November. So, you know, maybe I can do a cameo.
Jerry, I think you have that wrong. I think Ben Affleck has the Jerry DeWitt look.
Right. I would love for this whole thing to move towards Ben Affleck and away from Kevin Smith. And I love Kevin, you know, but I think I get called out for different reasons.
I'm curious, just as you're talking and you're talking about how you had doubts, when you were going through your education and seminar or whatnot, did you learn from a historical critical method, or did you learn from another type of method? Like, and did you have doubts even back then as you started to dig into like the history of the Bible and the like?
I'm in a unique position. Catherine and Teresa's stories will be much different. My version of Christianity, Pentecostalism, and in particular, my version of Pentecostalism, it discouraged higher education. Imagine that. And so I started in the ministry in the pulpit at age 17. So I had to be, as it were, self-taught. I had many wonderful ministers that were my mentors. And as I moved away from hardcore Pentecostalism and moved into the charismatic movement, I did set and study under more educated ministers, but I had no formal training, which explains a lot.
So have you read the Bible cover to cover, Jerry?
I've not only read the Bible cover to cover, I've probably preached the Bible cover to cover. But, you know, the trick is, it's one thing to study at the Bible, to, as a minister, to pull scriptures out. You know, when you, as a minister, particularly as a pastor, you go to the Bible already with a message, as it were, on your heart, something that you feel like is necessary and positive for the community, for the church that you're pastoring. And really, the Bible just becomes a context that you can frame this message within. So you can read the Bible all day long, and that's not going to give you the information, and sometimes the very painful information, that you're going to receive if you actually study the construction of the Bible itself. So it was very late in my ministry that I actually backed way up so that I could see the forest for the trees and say, you know, let's talk about the actual makeup of the Bible itself. So it's two different ways of looking at the Bible.
May I pose that same question to Teresa? Have you read the Bible cover to cover, Teresa?
Oh, goodness gracious. Probably by the time I was 10. I mean, I studied it. I taught it. I preached it. And unlike Jerry, just, you know, different perspective, I intentionally dug into those difficult passages and attempted to teach them because I felt they were the ones that people struggled with most. And that may be one of the keys. Actually, it was one of the keys that led me to the place where I am today. Because, you know, as my sister tells me, I think too much. I don't want to take somebody's word for it. I don't want to take even somebody's book for it. I love Dawkins' book, The God Delusion, but when I read it while I was still working through all this stuff, I read a lot of other things, some things that contradicted him and some things that confirmed what he was saying. Now, that's a difficult thing for me because he's an evolutionary biologist and I was a pastor and theologian, you know, but hey, I did my best.
Yeah, Teresa, you said something interesting before, which, and I'm paraphrasing here, but essentially what I heard you say was that you were kind of struggling with your faith before you even realized you were wrestling with your faith. What did that feel like? I mean, especially for other people who might be behind the pulpit that are maybe struggling and not realizing what they're struggling with themselves.
You know, Todd, that's a terrific question, and it's one that's very difficult to answer. For years, I was in this place, just like I described a minute ago, refusing to take answers, taking the pat answers, wanting to dig and learn for myself. And I was finding answers. And I was happy about that, but I didn't like the answers. So I would fight within myself. I would have this battle, and I would tell myself, no, that's not what it means, and that can't be true. And I would try to justify it and rationalize it and convince myself, you're just going through, as my dad would say from North Alabama, you're going through a spell. I was being shaped and formed, and, you know, as the Bible says, I was being tried by fire, and I would come out on the other side as pure gold. You know, and those were my thoughts. But in reality, it was this huge battle where I was realizing, recognizing, and learning the truth, but at the same time, refusing to admit it. Mm-hmm. And it honestly, Linda Lascola, Margaret mentioned her a minute ago, it wasn't until I sat down with her to do my interview for the second phase of the Dennett-Lascola study. She prodded me and poked me and questioned me and interviewed me, and it wasn't until then that I actually fully realized the transformation that had occurred. Hmm. And was willing to admit it. You know, that's the key right there. I was willing to admit it.
Mm-hmm. Catherine, did you go through the same Lascola interview process?
I did. But I think, like, my epiphany, and that's how I refer to it, happened in a slightly different way than Teresa's. I was doing my Master's of Divinity when it kind of hit me in the face. And even though I was going through divinity school at a Catholic university and going to become a Catholic chaplain, I was a liberal Catholic theologian. At least that's how I thought of myself. So very much into liberation theology and social justice and all those good things that those nuns driving around on a bus are proponents of. And also feminist theology played a very large part in deconstructing the religious worldview that I had previously. And as a woman in the Catholic Church, you're constantly confronted with your second class status. And somehow, as a thinking person, that just didn't feel right, right? It made no sense. And then when you couple that with the eruption of sexual abuse scandals that started, I think, really coming to the front while I was going through high school and my undergrad, I recognized that the church wasn't as perfect as it claimed to be, and that it was still a work in progress. And that's one of those things that I believe a lot of ministers and pastors and theologians, you know, they tell themselves, well, this is a work in progress. God is slowly revealing himself or herself or whatever you want to call it to me as a lowly human. There is a translation disconnect. You know, I'm only getting part of the message. Those are the types of things that I told myself as I let things sit and I contemplated what I was doing, spending all this time studying theology. What was the goal that I had? Why was I aspiring to purport these ideals, or when some of them were in direct conflict with the things that I valued, like social justice or the women and children? And so when I let go of Satan and all that sort of stuff during my undergrad in philosophy class. So theologians and religious thinkers are very good at compartmentalizing their religious ideas and ideals that they hold, you know, that are kind of a holy thing to them. And they put it in a sacred little safe space and they say off limits and they don't touch it. But you still go back to it, you know, and circle around it with a doubt, right? And until you're able to just let that go and break through that wall to the other side where you recognize that all of these ideologies don't matter. You know, it's a really scary, it's like jumping off a cliff and not knowing there's anything there.
Well, you can also liken it to heavily investing in a stock. and then finding out that that stock is useless and under or no value at all. And you have to admit to yourself that you invested too much money into this stock and, you know, it's time to let it go.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's very difficult for people. And that's where the Clergy Project that's online helping others who have invested so much of their life into something that they need to let go is very helpful. We are also seeing that the Clergy Project is helping people find positions and jobs. Once they lose their faith, they're going to lose their job. Tell us more about that particular angle.
I have to give kudos to someone else here. I have to give kudos to Todd because Todd and the Stiefel Foundation donated funds to help us to provide outplacement resource job preparation for our members who are interested in leaving ministry and finding secular employment. So this program is geared specifically to our members. We're working with a company that's protecting the anonymity of our members, but still able to provide sufficient and excellent service, actually, in helping our members understand what their skills are from ministry and take that skill set and communicate it to a secular employer, which is it's a hard thing to do for two reasons. One, because if ministry is the only thing you know, you're not really sure how to think outside of that box, right? Well, how could I take the community building skills that I have in ministry and, say, translate them in an education environment or in a nonprofit environment? So this company, Rise Smart, is helping our members to assess their skills, update their resumes, provide them with some testing and other assessments to help them to better recognize that, and then placing them with a contact, a job developer, to help them to source job opportunities in their area. So it's a tremendous program, and it wouldn't be operational if it was not for Todd and for the Stiefel Freethought Foundation. So thank you, Todd.
Hey, well, I do want to clarify one thing. We're not trying to stifle free thought.
No. Oh, sorry.
It's Stiefel, technically.
I always say stifle. I'm sorry. It's my Canadian accent.
You know, I would say like 95% of people pronounce it stifle. It's so frequent, actually, that I've considered changing the spelling, but just gave
so
up.
So very sorry. It's my Canadian accent. I'm blushing.
What you can do is remember the Stiefel with the chapel.
Yes, actually, that's what just came to my mind. I'm going to think of you as more priestly now, Todd. I hope you don't mind. You are the steeple in our, you know, the steeple, a steeple. There we go. It's now stuck in my head. Thank you.
And people also.
And people.
People, yeah. Steeple.
That's better than a friend in high school who called me the Stiefel Tower, which which is just embedding the mispronunciation more. So it's a different building. Okay.
Yes, yes, yes.
But that's so perfect for you because of how tall you are. And you're leaning to the left.
I'd love to hear some coming out stories, like what it was like before, during, and after coming out as a humanist or atheist when behind the pulpit. I mean, I'm sure that's an intense experience.
Actually, journey stories are really something that we should be promoting throughout the non-theist community because, you know, we're going to not change hearts and minds of people by giving scientific facts and countering, you know, with logic and reason. What people want to hear are our emotional journey stories, and they can relate to, you know, how we came about to throw away our religious beliefs, but we can't do that without written stories or, you know, the ability to express ourselves in a story form. And a lot of the non-theists don't exercise that type of communication as clearly as they could. And I would like to see more emphasis on that exactly, Todd. In fact, I go around the country doing a lecture about writing your own journey story, because I think we need to get those out there on the internet, on podcasts, and in general, to be able to convey who we are and why we concluded the things we did about religion.
Can I relay a story to this effect that, I mean, looking back on it now, when it happened at the moment, I don't think I recognize the significance of it. I was a 14 or 15 year old girl, religious Catholic, attending Mass every Sunday, praying the rosary. Yes, all like the whole nine yards. And my mom, this was just around the time that the sexual abuse scandal started erupting out of Boston and all over North America. And the bishop, that was so Freudian. Yes, the bishop in my diocese at the time issued a letter to the diocese and was read from every pulpit. And he was talking about a sexual abuse scandal that was very close to our community. And in this letter, this man said that it was the fault of the victims, that they had seduced these priests because they were, yes, exactly, because they were these... because they were prepubescent, right? So something they had done. And also that if they, you know, if these altar boys hadn't wanted this to happen, then they wouldn't have kept going back to Mass. Yeah, that was what was read from the pulpit.
The famous and, prepubescent sex drive.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. So that didn't sit really well with me. And when it was, it didn't sit well with many people sitting in the pews. A couple weeks later, my mom sent me off to youth camp to enjoy the countryside and Jesus and Catholicism. And who shows up but this bishop? And he is trying to, I guess, make inroads with the youth, considering his ridiculous statements. One of the girls at the camp got up and asked him why he would say such hateful things about these victims. And we are all kind of shocked and all holding our breath, right? I've never seen a man turn puce faster in my entire life. He became enraged. How dare she ask him these questions? She doesn't know. She's too young. And he just basically reiterated his key points in his letter. And we all got up and walked out on him.
Awesome.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hooray.
Hooray. And now as the person, the humanist, the atheist that I am, I look back on that story and I see that that is that first point in me leaving the church, recognizing the dysfunction, corruption, and evilness that is there, and wanting nothing to do with it, and recognizing that there is something outside of it, and there are values outside of religion that I think we all espouse, and that we should be, like as you said, Margaret, we should be telling those stories, because we are storytelling creatures, and it's part of who we are, so...
And Teresa, do you have an aha moment? And I say aha with emphasis on American Humanist Association.
I was just thinking of that. And, you know, I'm asked that question frequently. I don't. I have several. I mean, it was such a progression for me. And I think that's just because of my questioning, thinking, exploring, digging, researching personality and nature. I had a few moments where I've talked about many times where I came to realize that the Bible wasn't accurate, that it wasn't true, that hell couldn't exist, that I moved into really a deistic perspective for a period of time where I felt that every religion was equally valid, and based on our culture and upbringing, we chose to we relate to God in that specific way. I guess the big aha moment for me would be, as I said, meeting with Linda LaScola and admitting to myself that these things had happened and that I truly no longer believed and was an atheist. Now, as that was an aha moment for me, it was also an oh me moment, because I'm an active pastor. I'm an active clergy person. I'm in the pulpit every Sunday preaching, and with that recognition and admitting that fact, I don't know where to go, what to do, or how to get out. You know, my morals that I possess as an atheist, which many people say I don't have morals or ethics, they immediately begin to tear away within me. And just, I don't know how I kept my sanity through that whole period. And some would also say that I'm probably not very sane, but it was truly a 44-year journey for me to come to the point to where I could openly, honestly say and admit, I no longer believe, I'm an atheist, and I've got to do something to make a change.
What age were you, Jerry DeWitt, when you had your revelation about...
Well, let's see, I'm 43 now, so I would say somewhere around the age of 42. No, it was, like Teresa, it was an extremely long process. I was given a presentation in Austin, Texas, and you know, I've given so many presentations now that I've been out that you just say some things habitually. And I said it took me 25 years to deconstruct the religious traditions of my childhood, and someone in Austin yelled out from the audience, "You're a slow learner." and so, you know, we've all laughed about it ever since, and it's true. I felt like from the very beginning, I started in the ministry at 17, and even though I didn't like the answers I was finding, quoting Teresa, even though I didn't like the answers I was finding, I actually thought that I was getting more and more spiritual. Over the course of 25 years of study and of moving from one degree of fundamental denominationalism to the next, I really thought I was getting closer to God. I really thought I was becoming more and more like the apostles of the early church. That was part of my goal the entire time. And so it really built up and built and built and built higher and higher, higher up onto this peak until I just fell off the other side because there was nowhere else to go. There was actually nothing there. And so, you know, I had a couple of pretty intense aha moments. Unfortunately, it takes about 100,000 words in a book to describe all of this. But, you know, it really started off at age 17, wrestling with the idea of eternal punishment, and it ended with realizing that I was no longer a Christian. I was working my way from deism completely to agnosticism and then atheism, and finally having to accept that there was no place for me in Christian ministry. I really thought that I could bear the burden of the duplicity. I could bear the burden of the guilt of living a double life. I could bear that burden if it would somehow benefit the people that I loved and if it would somehow keep me effective in the ministry in a positive way for the people of the community that I cared about. And so the last aha moment was realizing I couldn't stay a minister.
Well, congratulations on being the first graduate of the Clergy Project.
I appreciate that very much. I think the Clergy Project board as a whole is trying to figure out a way to get away from this graduate word, even though it's been very, very effective for translating the process to everyone. But we want to make sure people realize that within the Clergy Project, there's actually no process to go through and to graduate from. It's really about graduating to me. I don't like to say that I lost my faith. I like to consider myself as having passed the test and graduated from my studies of religion. So thank you very much.
Teresa, I have a question for you. Since we've been on Facebook going back and forth about the questions being hard, we're multitasking.
Yes.
So the biggest criticism I've heard from Christians mostly regarding the Clergy Project is that once someone who is a pastor or a member of the clergy realizes that they don't believe anymore, they should immediately leave the church and be honest and stop preaching what they don't believe, and that the people who stay for even a moment are being dishonest to themselves, they're misleading their flock, and they are, you know, really committing atrocities and dishonesty and harming other people that trust them. What do you say to those people?
You're right. This is a tough question. And the answer isn't simple. And no matter what answer a person gives, I don't know that you can be 100% certain that it's the right answer or the right step. I have felt, like they said, especially when I was still in ministry, I felt like a fraud. I felt like the things that I was doing was just absolutely abhorrent, and that I should have walked away and should have left and did whatever, you know, dug a ditch, or which that wouldn't be really nice because I'm out of shape and much older now. But at the same time, there is reality that has to be dealt with. And reality is I'm a middle-aged woman. Reality is I have an income that is like most every American that I know. We can't do without it, not even for one pay period. The reality is my husband, he's still a Christian. He's still a believer. And he knew about it. And he's like, no, you just can't walk away. You have to have a job first, you know, with panic in it. The reality is we have education invested. We have time invested. And in a lot of ways, those things, they do translate into secular employment, but most secular employers don't realize that. There are others who I know in the Clergy Project who are older than I am and close to retirement, and they struggle. Do I give up, you know, 25, 30 years of doing this, and I'm so close? Others have family members who have medical issues, and if they walk away, they're going to have their spouse or their children will have pre-existing cause issues to deal with a new insurance policy. I mean, these things are extremely complicated. And for somebody just to give a pat answer and say, oh, you're wrong, you should just walk away, you know, I would challenge them to be in our position and do that. Now, for me, I know that after I came to that conclusion, I probably preached more biblically accurate sermons than I ever did in the entire history of my ministry, because I was convinced, that's not a good word for it, but I can't think of one right now. I was committed that I was going to fulfill the duties of my calling, of my job, until I could walk away, and immediately began to do everything I could to get out. I've told many folks, I worked a second job, 40 hours a week, working another job to pay off some credit card bills and to try and make the transition easier. But in the end, I just couldn't do it anymore. And I did walk away without having another job lined up.
I just wanted to add to what Teresa said, that leaving ministry for, you know, the great wide secular world, yeah, it seems kind of like an easy thing. You don't believe it anymore, so, you know, don't do it. But whenever anyone leaves another, you know, a job, if it's their choice, then there's always a planning stage, right? It just doesn't happen overnight. And the other thing is, even though being a minister or a pastor is a job, it's a lot more complicated than that. There are many different threads that get tangled. Your community, your family, you know, the expectations of your congregation or your parents, your children. It's not something that you can easily let go of. There's always going to be a push and a pull. And so I think it's very easy for someone to say, just pick up and leave. Well, let's see you pick up and leave your job and, you know, at the drop of a hat because you don't like your employer, right? You know, a lot of people don't like their jobs. They show up for work every Monday, right? So I think it's a little unfair for just the average Joe to think that it's going to somehow be different for clergy persons. So that's just my two cents on that subject.
Yeah, and I will add into that, which I think it applies, is the fact that even now, I haven't been out quite a year yet. And Jerry, you can probably echo in on this as well. I am still desperately trying to decide or define who I am away from church, away from religion, away from ministry. I spend many days, you know, I don't know where to go. I don't know what to do. I don't know how to connect well, which sounds funny because I was a pastor. I'm a people person. Mm-hmm. But the world is so different out here. And that's really something that has to be, you know, it was a lot of my thought process. And I wasn't prepared for how very, very difficult it was going to be. You know, I'm really, really lucky that the atheist community has welcomed me. You know, you guys, all of you that are online now, I count as good friends, and your support has meant the world to me. But, you know, all these issues, like Catherine said, if an attorney is representing somebody and they know they're guilty, they still do their job and represent that person. Mm-hmm. They don't believe what they're doing, but you don't see them going up to the judge and say, you know what, I just can't do this anymore. I don't believe it. No, they continue to do their job, and they do it well.
Jerry, do you want to add to that?
Sure. It's, you know, I'm still in the process of coming out and truly picking up and echoing what Teresa was saying, as she suggested. I'm still in the process of trying to define myself and trying to grow, trying to recover from religion. Just a few days ago, my bankruptcy was finally settled. I applied and filed for bankruptcy over 7 months ago. So, you know, for 7 months, if there was nothing else to think about, there would have been this bankruptcy to think about every day and every night, every sleepless night. Along with that, my wife and I, we're still separated. We live in two different states. We're communicating, seeing if there's any way to try to save a marriage. There's virtually no income. I pretty well attempt to sustain myself by speaking at small groups all across the country. And, you know, sometimes that's, a $50 profit for having, drove for a day to get to a small group. It's obviously still very much a matter of the heart and something that I'm doing, I hope, with the intentions of making the world a better place. But, you know, the process is, it's not as simple by any means as walking up to the pulpit and saying, guess what, guys, I read something last night that changed my mind about everything, because it's not just your mind that is changing. It is your entire world that is changing. And so what I try to get across as I'm speaking to these groups is these types of decisions and this commitment to stand on your integrity, it has to be worth your world to you. Mm-hmm. It has to be worth your marriage. It has to be worth your relationships with your children or possibly even your grandchildren. It has to be worth being uncomfortable shopping for groceries at Walmart. It has to be worth, for many people, leaving your home, moving. It has to be worth everything. It has to literally be worth everything, because you really don't know if it's going to cost everything or not. So you have to be prepared to lose everything. And so it's complicated and it's hard.
Mm-hmm. I want to applaud all of you for your bravery, because it sounds extraordinarily difficult. I mean, I think anybody who finds reason, if you will, it can be a challenging transition. But when you mix career and family and community in there, it's got to be so much harder. So I applaud you, and also applaud what the Clergy Project is doing. And, you know, one thing I want to talk about briefly, because we're running out of time, is, you know, something really positive that the Clergy Project is doing to kind of redirect energy. And that is working with the AHA's Humanist Society in terms of creating more celebrants. Catherine, yeah. can you tell us about that?
Yes, this is really exciting. The Clergy Project has members now have a quick access route to apply for accreditation, I guess, as a humanist celebrant with the Humanist Society. So this is something that I was working on a couple months back. It took a bit of negotiation, but thanks to everyone at the table who was really open to making sure things fit well for the Clergy Project members and for the needs of the Humanist Society and the AHA, we were able to come up with a really great program. So Clergy Project members who are interested just can make their application basically through TCP, and then I submit the applications through to HS, the Humanist Society, and within 4 months they'll be accredited as celebrants. Just to let you know, just last week I received my paperwork, so I'm officially a celebrant.
Jerry, where is your next speaking engagement?
Let's see, my next speaking engagement, actually, I'm speaking at the 50th anniversary of the American Atheist in Austin in just a couple of weeks. And then from there, I believe that I go towards the Boston area. I'm speaking at Harvard, and then the next day at MIT, and then some local groups in that area.
And we're so happy to have Teresa MacBain on the schedule for Celebrate Humanism Conference, the 72nd Annual Conference of American Humanist Association, taking place May 30th through June the 2nd in San Diego. And Teresa, your speech title is really interesting. The Tin Man, Scarecrow, Lion, and Dorothy, Finding Community in Unlikely Places. Sounds great.
Yes, I've actually given the talk in a couple of to a couple of groups here in Florida, and it has been very well received. I don't know if many of the listeners are aware, but there's a buzz going on within the free thought community, free thought movement. I want to double use that word, about building community, about as in London has these atheist churches, and what does it mean, and should we move in that direction? So that's something that as clergy persons, we know a lot about. We are community builders. We are community managers. I was thinking about it on an airplane coming back home from a talk. Actually, it was before I came to Toronto, because Catherine helped me talk through the points. And I just came up with the idea that, hey, these four characters were very unlikely folks to be in community, but they made it work, and each of the elements that they brought to the equation are the very things that as free thinkers, as human beings, we need in order to develop and maintain this idea of a strong community.
And there was That's no awesome. Yellow brick road on your journey. It was no yellow brick road.
There was a wizard, though, and I pulled the curtain back and was shocked.
There you go.
I wanted to say something with regards to what Teresa was saying about community building, and one of those specifically that we do have a couple of Clergy Project members that have congregations that are in the process or have proceeded to migrate away from Christianity. So there is a model that, or several models that are there. I'm thinking specifically of Mike in Houston. And Greta Vosper in Toronto. Greta is unique because she is technically still tied to the United Church, but her congregation is humanist, and they do not follow the liturgical calendar with the rest of the United Church. So there is definitely an of-the-moment thing, this congregational atheism or humanism, and I'm very, very excited about it. So
that is awesome. Well, Teresa MacBain, Catherine Dunphy, and Jerry Dewitt, I really want to thank you so much for all your activism and hard work and courage. And thanks so much for being on the show. It's been awesome having you here.
It was great to co-host this podcast with you, Todd, and to get to know Teresa and Catherine and Jerry a little bit better. And I look forward to seeing all of you again. Well, Todd, I think that show is going to be a classic. I was so impressed with Jerry and Catherine and Teresa. Their journey stories were just not only interesting, but really heartwarming.
That was a lot of fun. That was awesome and emotional and uplifting and crazy all at once. And it was just, it was intense in many ways for me. I really enjoyed it. And that was awesome. And listeners, please let us know what you think. If you have any questions or ideas, give us a call at our listener comment line at 202-618-1371. And you can find previous episodes of Humanist Hour and show notes at thehumanisthour.org. Please also like us on Facebook. Margaret, thanks so much for co-hosting and being our guest host this month. I really enjoyed getting to work with you, and thanks so much.
It was my pleasure. Hope you call me again.
Indeed. All right, listeners, until next month, this is the Humanist Hour. Have a great one.
Here comes the sun, I say, it's all right.